Here we discuss about Bernoulli's principle. This Bernoulli's principle basically is applied to ideal fluids. What is an ideal fluid? The fluid is said to be ideal when it is non-viscous. Incompressible, irrotational, and steady. This type of fluid is said to be ideal fluid. The fluid should be first of all non-viscous. Non-viscous means there should be no viscous force. Viscous force is nothing but it is a fluid friction acts between two layers which opposes the relative motion between the fluid layers. We discuss about clearly viscosity in further topics. Now there should be no viscous force between the layers and fluid should be incompressible. Fluid is incompressible means density should be same at all points. Fluid is irrotational means there should be no net angular momentum at any point in the flow of fluid. Means as the fluid is flowing at any point, the rotation should be zero, means it could not rotate, and the fluid flow should be steady. Like this, whenever the fluid having these four characteristics, that is said to be steady fluid. Now for the steady fluid flow only, the Bernoulli's principle is applicable. Now, let's see what is a Bernoulli's principle now. The Bernoulli's principle states that when an when a non-viscous, incompressible, irrotational fluid flows steadily through a tube of flow, then along the line of flow, means along the streamline, then the sum of the pressure energy, potential energy and kinetic energy per unit volume remains constant at all points along the line of flow. Here it states that when a non-viscous, incompressible, irrotational steady fluid is flowing steadily through a tube of flow, then the sum of the pressure energy per unit volume, pressure energy is a pressure into volume, per unit volume is divided with volume, this is pressure energy per unit volume, plus potential energy per unit volume, potential is mgh, per unit volume is mgh by v, and kinetic energy per unit volume of mv square is kinetic energy, small v is velocity, capital V is volume, kinetic energy per unit volume. Sum of these three energies per unit volume is equals to constant. This is the statement of the Bernoulli's principle. Here volume is cancelled, now pressure remains. Here mass by volume is the density rho gh plus again m by v is the volume, m by v is the density rho, half rho v square is equals to constant. This is the statement of the Bernoulli's principle. Bernoulli's principle states that when a non-viscous, incompressible fluid flows steadily through a tube of flow, then the sum of the pressure energy per unit volume, potential energy per unit volume and kinetic energy per unit volume remains constant at all points along the line of flow. This is the Bernoulli's principle. Now let us try to prove this Bernoulli's principle. To prove this Bernoulli's principle, we consider a tube of flow of varying cross-sectional area. If cross-sectional area is varying, then velocity also varies. Now we consider here two cross-sections, cross-section 1 and cross-section 2 of tube of flow. The cross-section 1 at a height h1 from the horizontal level and cross-section 2 at a height h2 from the horizontal level, and the area of cross-section 1 is a1, of cross-section 2 area is a2. The velocity of fluid at cross-section 1 is v1, and the velocity of fluid flow at cross-section 2 is v2. As the fluid is incompressible, so density is same at cross-section 1 and 2, that is rho and rho, and pressure at cross-section which is acting inside is p1, and pressure at cross-section 2 also acting inside, that is P2. Now let's see that now as the fluid is flowing inside, there is some work done on the fluid by the pressure P1. Now we find the work done by the pressure P1 on the fluid at cross section 1. On fluid at a cross section 1 by pressure P1 is equal to P1 pressure into volume A1 V1 delta T. Here delta T is a time interval in which volume of the fluid A1 V1 delta T is entered. So here A1 V1 delta T is the volume. This much volume of fluid entered at a cross section 1 in a time interval delta T. So the work done on the fluid at cross section 1 by the pressure P1 is a P1 A1 V1 delta T. Here P1 A1 V1 delta T is the work done on the fluid at cross section 1 by the pressure P1. Similarly, at cross section 2, work done on fluid at cross section 2 by pressure P2 is equal to, this is minus, this is negative. I explain you why it is negative. Minus P2 A2 V2 delta T. Now here at a cross section 1, the pressure is acting inward, means if the pressure acting inward, force also acts inside and displacement also inside. Force and displacement both inside, so at a cross section 1, work is positive. At a cross section 2, the force, the pressure P2 acting inside, means force also acting inside, displacement is outside. Means force and displacement are in opposite directions, so at a cross section 2, work done is negative. So work done on fluid at a cross section 2 by pressure P2 is negative because force and displacement are in opposite direction. So it is minus P2 A2 V2 delta T. So that the total work done on the fluid due to the pressure difference at a cross section 1 and 2, total work done on fluid due to pressure difference is equal to, let it be WP. WP is the work done on the fluid due to the pressure difference, that is equal to P1 A1 V1 delta T minus P2 A2 V2 delta T. Now this is a total work done on the fluid due to the pressure difference at cross section 1 and 2. WP is equal to P1 A1 V1 delta T minus P2 A2 V2 delta T. And also due to the difference in height, there is also work done by the gravitational force on the fluid. Now we find the work done by gravitational force on fluid. Work done by gravitational on fluid, that is a WG. WG is the work done by gravitational force on fluid, that is equal to difference in potential energies at cross section 1 and at cross section 2. At cross section 1, potential energy is mgh1. At cross section 2, potential energy is mgh2. Now mgh1 minus mgh2 is the work done by gravitational force on fluid, that is WG. WG is equal to mgh1 minus mgh2. Now here due to the pressure difference, some work is done on the fluid, and due to the height difference also there is some work done on the fluid. Now the total work done is WP plus WG. Total work done on fluid, let it be W. W is equal to work done by pressure difference plus work done by gravitational force. W is equal to WP plus WG. Now the total work done on fluid W is equal to WP is P1 A1 V1 delta T minus P2 A2 V2 delta T plus WG is MgH1 minus MgH2. Now this is a total work done on the fluid by the pressure difference and gravitational force. But according to work energy theorem, we read that, we can write that the total work done is equal to change in kinetic energy According to work energy theorem, we know that the total work done by external force is equal to change in kinetic energy. Here also, total work done is this much, is equal to change in kinetic energy between cross section 1 and cross section 2. Total work done is, we know, P1 A1 V1 delta T minus P2 A2 V2 delta T plus mgh1 minus mgh2 is equal to change in kinetic energy. Kinetic energy at cross section 2 minus kinetic energy at cross section 1, that is half m v2 square minus half m v1 square. Here, what is m here? M is the mass of the fluid that entered at cross section 1 in time interval delta t, and same mass m leaves the cross section 2 in same time interval delta t. Okay, now we are dividing this equation both sides with a term mass. On both sides, dividing with the term mass. Now, we know the mass term. Mass can be written as a density into volume. Density into volume is AV delta T. Volume is AV delta T. Now, at cross section 1, mass can be written as rho A1 V1 delta T. At cross section 2, mass can be written as a rho A2 V2 delta T. Both the mass are same. At cross section 1, this much is the mass. At cross section 2, this much is the mass. But both the mass are same. So now m is equal to, we write rho a1 v1 delta t, rho a2 v2 delta t. Now this is a mass term. Now on both sides, we are dividing with the mass. Now here it is divided with the mass term. We are taking mass term as rho a1 v1 delta t minus, here we take mass term as rho a2 v2 delta t. Here it is a m, also m. So on both sides we divide with the mass. Now here a1 v1 delta t is cancelled, a2 v2 delta t, m cancelled. So what remains here? P1 by rho minus P2 by rho plus gh1 minus gh2 is equal half v2 square minus half v1 square. Now taking one terms to one side, two terms to another side, then we are getting that P1 by rho, taking a plus GH1 here, taking minus half V1 square this side, become plus half V1 square, is equal to taking minus P2 by rho this side, become plus P2 by rho, and minus GH2 this side, plus GH2, already plus half V2 square is there, half V2 square. Now we got P1 by rho plus GH1 plus of V1 square is equal to P2 by rho plus GH2 plus of V2 square. Commonly, we write here P by rho plus GH plus half V square is equals to constant. Or taking LCM of rho, then P plus rho GH plus half rho V square by rho is equals to constant. Here rho is the constant, divided by rho, taking rho this side, rho is the constant, constant into constant, again a constant. So we prove the Bernoulli's theorem like this: P plus rho GH plus of rho V square is equals to constant. Here P is the pressure energy per unit volume, rho GH is the potential energy per unit volume, half rho V square is the kinetic energy per unit volume. Sum of these three energies is equals to constant along the line of flow. Now this applicable for an ideal fluid. Ideal fluid means the fluid flow should be non-viscous. It is an incompressible, irrotational, steady flow. Now the statement of Bernoulli's theorem is that when a non-viscous, incompressible fluid flows steadily through a tube of flow, then the sum of the pressure energy, potential energy and kinetic energy per unit volume remains constant at all points of the line of flow. In this way, we prove the Bernoulli's theorem.